Megan, I'm glad you stayed in here. Because I, as you were telling your children's time, this doesn't have anything to do with the sermon, but as she was talking about the season of Lent, it reminded me of a story. Okay? So back in the day, I would teach a youth group, and we came to it, the season. I was wanting them to learn about the season of Lent, and I think, well, how do I? And this was at this time, my daughter was probably about your age, CJ, and she was in the youth group. And I said, well, how can I explain this to them? Now you use the illustration. It's not Lent isn't what comes out of the dryer. Well, as I thought I was on the same page as she was, but instead of saying Lent is not something that it's not Lent, it's Lent, it's not something that comes out of the dryer, I lifted up my shirt and pulled out a little ball of lint out of my belly button. My daughter has not forgiven me to this day. 14 years old, and she had all of her friends there, you know, and she's going, oh Lord Jesus, take me now. Has nothing to do with the sermon today, but I thought I'd bless you all with that. For those of you who believe that your pastor has a towering intellect, anybody? Didn't think so. But for any of you that might have had the inclination to believe that your pastor had a towering intellect, let me discourage you of that notion. I was never a good student. Never. Now, I wasn't a bad student. I just wasn't a great student. I was a right down the line kind of a B student. You know what I mean? There was a few smatterings of C's now and then. I did have one D, algebra. Hated algebra. But I had a few A's over here. But most of the time, I stayed in my lane. B's. Now, I tell you that as a foundation for this story that I'd like to share with you this morning. I was the pastor of this church, and happened to be in Davenport. And there was a gentleman that started coming to church with his family. And the reason why I say he started coming to church with his family, because I want you to know he didn't come to church because he was a believer. And he didn't want to be a believer either. He was coming for his family. The best way to describe him would be, I think he would have described himself as an agnostic, meaning he was someone who, he wasn't necessarily against the whole idea of God. It was more that he simply didn't believe that if there is a God, he didn't believe that that God was involved in our everyday lives. In fact, he believed that those of us who believed that were kind of religious rubes. He would never have said that, but because he was too gracious, but after getting to know him, I knew that's exactly what he was thinking. Well, as the months passed, something disconcerting began to happen to him. As he was coming to worship, he found himself enjoying it. And what was even worse, he found himself liking me. So he's thinking, I've got to do something. I got to stop this. So he came up with a plan. And the plan was that he was going to invite the pastor out for lunch one day. Because he believed that he needed to do something to regain his intellectual equilibrium, because he was a smart dude, okay? And he thought, I'm going to come up with all of the logical fallacies that exist in his mind because of Christianity, and I'm going to share these things with the pastor. And he wasn't doing that to try to trap me necessarily or to embarrass me. He literally, what he was trying to do is he was trying to go, I need to get back a hold of who I am because I'm going down a road that I don't want to go down or that I shouldn't. So I'm going to leave that story right there for just a second, okay? But I want you to remember that story as I share with you the main character of our passage of Scripture. Did anybody read ahead this week? Acts chapter 6. The main character in Acts chapter 6, if you read ahead, you'll know, is a guy named Stephen. My brother's name is Stephen, and it's spelled just like in the Bible, and people often read the way it's written there in the Bible as Stephen, or I used to let, you know, anyway. But his name is Stephen, and What I want you to notice about Stephen, or there's basically only, there's two chapters in the Bible that talk about Stephen. So we don't know a lot about who he is, but we do know a few things, and that's just, we're going to kind of do a character profile of Stephen today. But basically what I want you to know when you boil it all down is this. Stephen really was just an average guy, like you and me. He was an average guy, however, who loved Jesus and was willing to serve however Jesus wanted to use him. Now that's very important for you to hear, all right? It's very, very important for you to keep in mind that he's just an average guy. He's not a towering intellect, in other words, or he's not this, wah, you know. He's just an average person like you and me who loved Jesus and was willing to serve, all right? Keep those things in mind as we look at our passage today. If you haven't already done it, open them up to Acts chapter 6. And as you're doing that, I'll give you just a little bit of recap, what we need to know that will help inform us for what we're going to look at today. If you've been with us the last couple of weeks, you'll know that the church, the early church in its infancy, was in hyperdrive, right? The early church, there were literally thousands and thousands of people who were becoming believers in Christ, who were becoming a part of the church, which was an awesome thing, which is exactly what God intended and what the apostles had hoped for. But that carried with it some growing pains, I guess you could probably say. Because there were so many people coming into the church in such a fast way every day, the disciples or the apostles began to feel themselves stretched to the breaking point. That's what we're finding here in Acts chapter 6. They were stretched to the breaking point. There were things that needed to happen that weren't happening. They were juggling a lot of balls in the air, and a lot of them were falling. People's needs were not being met, and some of the folks started to grumble about it. Rightfully so, really. So, it says in Acts chapter 6, verse 3, that the apostles came up with a plan, basically. They said to the church, they said, y'all need to find 7 godly people who you discern the Spirit in, because we're going to turn over the administrative needs of the church to those 7 people. Okay, so I'm going to stop right there for just a second, because I want to point out some facts that aren't mentioned here. I want you to notice that they don't mention here in Acts chapter 6 that the apostles or the church hired a headhunting firm, right? A search firm. They didn't do that to fill these positions. You'll also notice that they did not have folks take personality profiles, nor did they have them take spiritual gifts inventories. They did, however, have criteria for who these 7 people ought to, for what was required of these 7 people if they were going to serve the administrative needs of the church. And they were going to, so they could give these needs over to these 7 people so that the apostles could pray and teach. Okay? So, notice the requirements: that they be godly people, that they love Jesus, they sense the Spirit within them, and they were willing to serve. Do I need to go over those 3 again? Because that's really all there was. Do they love Jesus? Do you sense the Spirit within them? And are they willing to serve? Now, the reason why I mention that is because there are times, there are going to be times in your life, there are times, there have been times in my life, there will be times moving forward when the Holy Spirit is going to call you to serve in ways that you may not feel gifted, that you may not have a passion for. But when the Holy Spirit calls and asks you to serve, You say yes because you love Jesus, the Spirit has worked within you, because you wouldn't have sensed it, and you're willing. Not because you have it all figured out, not because you've got lots of experience necessarily, but because you love Jesus and the Spirit's working in you and you're willing. Now, having said that, I also want you to know that when the Spirit calls like that, when there is a need and He's simply looking for someone who is willing, you will not be expected to stay in that position forever. In fact, you should be preparing yourself to get out of that position as soon as possible. So that as soon as a person who has the passion, the gifts and graces, the skill, whatever, is ready and raised up, that you can step out of it. But in the meantime, you do. Okay, that brings us to Stephen. We have no idea whether Stephen or any of the other six were gifted administrators. We don't know. All we know is that they loved Jesus and they were willing, right? But this is verse 8. Look at verse 8, because verse 8 I find extremely interesting. It says in verse 8, and this is what Hannah read for us, it says that God empowered Stephen to do miracles and wonders among the people. Is that what your Bible says, pretty much? Is that it? That God empowered Stephen to do miracles and wonders among the people. Now, we get no idea, other than the fact that all these seven people that were chosen, the Spirit was at work within them, we have no other inclination that before he was called to be an administrator, Stephen had the ability to be or to perform miracles and wonders. It appears that when he proved himself faithful in one ministry, God said, okay, now I'm going to move you to another ministry. You see, listen to me now. You may not have the same passion, interest, calling at every stage of your Christian life. In fact, I would go so far as to say if you're growing in the Spirit, if you proved yourself faithful, God will continually be moving and making and doing things through you that may be different all the time. The question is, do you love Jesus? And are you willing? Because that's the other thing I'll have you notice about this story about Stephen. At no point did anyone ask Stephen what he was interested in doing. Do you notice that? No, at no point did anyone say, well, let's figure, what gives you life? God didn't do that. He said, the question was, God, what do you want me to do? Do you love Jesus? And are you willing? See, I make things simple because I'm not a towering intellect. All right? Do you love Jesus? And are you willing? Now, I bring all this up. I was drawn to this story of Stephen today because of something that I've heard for over 30 years as a pastor. I can't tell you how many times I've heard this from people. It is the exception for me to meet people who say, this is what I'm called to do. This is what I'm passionate about. And I really like to serve the Lord. And this is what I was created. That is the exception. You want to know what I hear most of the time from people? I have no idea what I have to offer God. I can't sing. I don't do this. I'm not an administrator. Right? You know what I'm talking about, right? I'm not talking about you. Most of the time, what I hear is people going, I don't have anything. I don't have anything to offer to God or to the church. So if that happens to be you, whatever you're thinking about right now, clear your mind, because I'm about to lay a truth bomb on you that will change your life forever and ever. Ready? Listen. God does not generally call the equipped. What does God do? God equips the called. Do I need to say it again? I may need to explain it, but God does not call the equipped generally. He equips the called. Basically, what that means, what that's saying is that God is not looking for someone who is all that, who thinks they've got it figured out. In fact, I'd go so far as to say to you that the ones who think they're equipped and called and are all that, they get in the way all the time. Because God doesn't need anyone doing things for him. What does God need? God wants people who he's willing to do things or are willing to allow him to do things through. God doesn't call the equipped. He equips the called. What you need is to love Jesus and be willing. Which brings me back to the story I told you about. You thought I forgot about it, didn't you? I didn't forget. So, we're going to lunch. My agnostic friend and I, we go to lunch. Starts out good, and then he starts bombarding me with all these logical fallacies, right? And all of a sudden, I'm getting it. The light bulb goes off. Now I know what this is all about. And I enjoy it because I love having these conversations. And I thought for a while there, I am a towering intellect because I answer good. But then I realized I was not even close to his intellectual equal. It wasn't that I was answering his questions or his debate poorly. It was just that he was always smarter with the next question or the next answer than I was with mine. He was like two or three steps ahead all the time. You ever met anybody like that? I hate those people. So I'm listening. I realize this is just kind of going around in circles. We're not getting anywhere. And then it happened. And I'd like to say that I heard a voice. It wasn't like that. It was just like this kind of thing inside of me. But if I were to put into words this thing inside of me, it would have sounded something like this. Craig, stop trying to argue this guy into the kingdom. You ain't that smart. Instead, simply tell him the difference that I make in your life. Tell him that once you were lost and now you're found. Tell him that once you had no meaning and purpose and now your life is filled with meaning and purpose. Just tell him. So I did. See, that's one thing I'm an expert on. The difference that Jesus has made in me. You can't argue with me about the difference that Jesus has made in me. Because I'm the expert. So I told him. And he had no quick retort. No snappy debate. It was just silence. You want to know why? Because setting before him was the answer that he had been looking for. He wasn't really looking for theological logic. He was looking for, is there hope for me? And when I was able to share with him that there was hope for me, the logical implication was, well, then there must be hope for him, too. Now, is that going to work for everybody? I doubt it. I don't know. All I can tell you is that I wish I could tell you that I was just that smart. And I came up with that on my own, but I can't. All I can tell you is that there was somebody who loved Jesus and was willing to be used in that instance. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Because what happened right there at that very moment, folks, listen to me now, all of your excuses were just taken away. Did you know that? Did you feel that happening? Because if you didn't, pay attention, because that's exactly what happened in that very moment. All your excuses were just taken away. Because all God is looking for is what you are responsible for and have the ability to do. Do I love Jesus? And am I willing to be used? And then the rest of it's up to him. Pretty simple. I'm wondering whether there's people online right now, maybe there's somebody sitting in here who has yet to say, to make the choice personally, I love Jesus. I'm not talking about religion. I'm talking about a relationship with Jesus. If there is anybody here today or listening online, you have the opportunity to make that choice today. And you can only do it for yourself. Your grandma can't do it for you. Only you can do that. And if you make that choice, and what you need to understand about all that is that making the choice to believe by faith, this is what my friend that day began to understand. Making the choice to believe isn't making the choice to say, I get it. I get it all. I understand everything. It's in fact making the choice to believe that I believe even when I don't understand everything. That's called faith. Did you know that? I choose to place my faith in you, Jesus. When you choose to make that choice, you know what it says in 2 Corinthians? It says that the scales fall away from your eyes when you choose to place your faith in him, even though you don't have all the answers. If you'd like to make that choice today, it's very simple. It's just saying, Jesus, I have sinned. I'm sorry. Forgive me. I give my life to you today. I choose to have faith in you. It's really not any more complicated than that. And making that choice changes everything. If you would like to say that prayer today, I'm going to be standing right over there by the prayer room as I try to do every week. And if you'd like to pray that prayer with me, I'd love to pray that prayer with you, but you don't need me to do that. You can say that prayer, just you and Jesus, whether you're listening online today or a week from now or a year from now, you can do it. Just don't wait too long, okay? Because you're not promised tomorrow. None of us are. So choose today who you will have faith in and who you will serve. And my prayer is that it is Jesus.
My home. scars caused by my sin is where my life begins.
How great
and how great is your love. How great is your love for me. How great is your love. How great is your love for me.
My heart can't contain.
My heart cannot contain this joy brought by your pain. Such grace I can't repay.
Let's give it up.
Still I give my
the height or depth. So high.
So high. So deep. So great that it's overwhelming. So high. So deep. So
and pray with me.
As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee.
Lord Jesus, we acknowledge
this morning that the only appropriate response to the great love that you've shown us is service, Lord. The only appropriate response is to take that love that you've given us and send it right back out into the world, which you also love. Will you please, by the power of your Holy Spirit, fill us up and enable us to do just that. As we go out to our workplaces, as we go home, as we go to our friends and our neighbors, Lord, will you please help us carry your love into the rest of the world? We pray and we ask this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you all so much for being here. Have a great week.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, sin runs deep, your grace is more. The grace is found, is where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me.
Good Father, it's who you are, it's who you are.